Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's purpose-driven discussion hosted by TikTok. I am very excited and honored to be moderating this conversation. This is a topic that I'm very passionate about. Before we get into this, I do want to introduce myself. My name is Michelle K. Hanabusa, pronouns she, her, hers. I am a fourth generation Japanese Okinawan American, dreamer and entrepreneur. I currently run two different organizations, the first one being We Are UPRISERS, which is a community-driven streetwear brand that is rooted in telling stories of the underrepresented within our communities. You will find us collaborating with activists, trendsetters, people who we call warriors of change in order to transform and mobilize our communities. I also am a co-founder of a nonprofit called Hate is a Virus, which is dedicated to dismantling racism and other forms of hate. As you know, or as some of us are in this business, doing business today looks a lot different than it did before. Today's generation is more socially aware, and consumers really have found a way to utilize their power and their voice to affect change for not only themselves, but for culture and for the future. This puts us in a pivotal moment, right? And for us brands, it kind of creates a unique opportunity for us to start off with a core purpose, and if not, finding purpose along the way. And so I'm very excited to be chatting with three incredible brands today to talk about how they've used TikTok to connect with community, affect and inspire, and build positive change. With that said, I'm going to popcorn it over to Gayitri and would love for you to tell us who you are, what you do, and if you can popcorn it over to someone else.
Thank you, Michelle. So I'm Gayitri Budhraja. I'm the Vice President of Brand at E.L.F. Beauty. I would say that I put a lot of my focus in exploding the visibility of our brands in a really bold and disruptive way, and also staying true to our purpose. So E.L.F. Cosmetics is our flagship brand. We were founded back in 2000. In the last year and a half, we have acquired a brand, Well People, in the clean beauty space. And then we have also co-created a brand, a lifestyle beauty brand, with Alicia Keys, Key Soul Care. But the backbone in everything within our portfolio is we are bold disruptors with a kind heart. So we stand for accessible, inclusive, clean, cruelty-free beauty. And this is something that we radiate with everything that we do. So I'm going to pass it over to Brad.
Thank you so much. So I'm so glad that I get to introduce myself before my younger brother. So it's already a great day. I am the older brother, some say smarter brother, of the two blind brothers. Bryan and I have a clothing brand that gives 100% of our profits back to preclinical research to cure blindness. That's because we have a rare eye condition called Stargardt's disease, where you lose your center vision over time. We started this as a passion project about 5 years ago, but because of the digital age, because of platforms like TikTok, it's led us on the greatest adventure of our lives, a chance to give back to a cause that we care about, a lot of purposeful work for a very personal cause to Bryan and I, and just a great adventure. And with that, I guess since I took all the good stuff, I will pop it over to Bryan.
Oh, wonderful. My brother's already poking fights at the beginning of a lovely panel about being compassionate and running a business with passion for a cause. But no, it'll go great from here on out. A little more context. There are 11 million people in the U.S. that suffer from retinal eye disease. That's a lot of very connected individuals. And in our 5 years of existence, Two Blind Brothers has been able to donate $1.5 million to researchers. So we've been really happy and fortunate to be able to give back and form a community that we care so deeply about. And I will popcorn it to Kathryn.
Hello, thank you. Very, very happy to be joining everyone. My name is Kathryn Fernandez. I'm the Global Brand Director of Dove Master Brand, overseeing purpose specifically for the US market. I've been with Unilever for almost 10 years, and on Dove, we're on a mission to make positive experience of beauty universally acceptable to everyone. And we've been deeply ingrained in purpose now for nearly two decades, from the campaign to real beauty, to igniting conversations around Photoshop and the impact on self-esteem, to launching the Dove Self-Esteem Project and making sure that caregivers and adolescents have the tools they need to make sure they're growing up confidently with the most self-esteem they can possibly have. And most recently, taking the pledge for no digital distortion and having a lot of conversations around self-digital distortion when it comes to social media with our recent campaign on Selfie Talk. So very happy to be here, super excited about the conversation today. Thank you.
Amazing. Thank you all again for being here today. And as mentioned before, we are all having this conversation because each and every one of you have built an incredible purpose-driven brand. And in my eyes, it's more than just marketing, right? It's a way of doing business. It's a lifestyle. And so leading with purpose is so unique for every brand, and it looks different for every brand. And it oftentimes starts with purpose at the core. Bryan and Bradford would love for you guys is to kick it off and elaborate more on how your brand embodies purpose as a organization.
Go ahead, little brother.
You're really going after the little thing. I mean, people can see your gray hair, man. I don't think anyone was confused which one of us was younger. It's fascinating for Brad and I because, you know, our purpose is to help cure blindness and to grow and empower a community within the visually impaired. And it's amazing because some brands have to search for their purpose. They have to find what really drives them, find the thing that ignites their soul, makes them excited, and the causes they care so much about. For Brad and I, it was really simple. It was, we want selfishly to cure ourselves, and we want to cure everyone like us. And when we started Two Blind Brothers years and years ago, neither of us had any backgrounds in fashion, marketing, manufacturing, cut and sew, branding, website, anything helpful to running a company. But what we did have was our story. And we found very early on that telling our story and telling it as authentically and true to who we were every single day was what resonated with people. You know, we find it so interesting when we use TikTok or we use any social platform, every time that we try and overproduce and get in our own way and try and tell our story, make our story fit somewhere it doesn't necessarily, we perform way less well. And when we just speak to exactly who we are, to the audience that cares most about us, and truly with all of our heart and soul preach our message, that is really when we find a lot of gold.
I'm even feeling just like the passion that you have. And I think it's so important to kind of lead into a business with this much passion, right? I do want to now touch a little bit more on the community aspect for a bit. Community building, right, is very much different for each brand, and it can very much evolve over time. Gayitri, would love for you to talk a little bit more about this, especially since you are an early adopter as a brand on TikTok.
You know, when I think about galvanizing a community, I loved Bryan's point around authenticity. And you absolutely have to be clear on what you stand for as a brand. And ELF stands for every eye, lip, face, and paw. And our approach back then was really, how do we amplify our core purpose-driven mission, which is ELF is for every eye, lip, and face. And so we had this very bold idea, which is we're going to come up with an original music composition and see what put that out there in the universe and see if that catches fire. 5, 6, 8,
y'all need to hype me up. Do that thing with your eyes. Money, look. Let me see them lips. Mwah. Attitude and give me face. Boom, 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 boom. Eyes, lips, face, wait.
And I think what we saw immediately is it was something that became more than a campaign. It became a movement. And part of the reason why that happened is it tapped into this, I would say what was resonant about it is this idea that ELF is for everyone. There was no prescription around what we put around it. It really was just enabling this unbridled self-expression and allowing the community to self-express. So I think part of the success of that campaign was really rooted in figuring out how do we take what we stand for as a brand and connect that to what we know is going to excite the TikTok community and do that in a way that feels completely authentic.
Amazing. And you know, that strategy that you started off with, has that continuously evolved over time, or is that something that you've kind of found almost like a niche and a strategy that you are carrying on throughout the years?
Yeah, what I would say, I mean, E.L.F. is, you know, what we love to say is E.L.F. is by the people, of the people, for the people. So everything we do is so community driven. And I think one of our aims is really to spotlight those individuals that may otherwise not get noticed. What I love about TikTok is TikTok makes fame accessible. And that completely intersects with the value of E.L.F., which is how do we make things accessible? And how do we use our platforms to give others a voice? So there've been so many incredible activations that we've launched on TikTok that have been completely in community. Eyes Lips Famous is another example of this, which the idea was, we know that people want to become famous on TikTok. And so how do we use our platform to connect individuals who want to become famous with mega influencers, send them through essentially a beauty camp, and use our platform to elevate their voice in a way that they otherwise, you know, may not have had before. So for us, I think what's fun about the innovation here is that if you're able to go back to the mission that you're trying to drive and just radiate that with consistency in everything you're doing, it's going to excite just very passionately the community that you're going after. And that community is just going to get behind what you're doing because they see that connection between what you say you're standing for and the actions that you're taking behind that.
I really like what you talked about in terms of like elevating voices of others. I think that it is so much more important than just partnering with the hottest celebrities out there. And, you know, it's really about finding the authentic voice for your brand as well, and creators who can really represent that as a brand and be relatable to your target audience. Kathryn, I would love to kind of move this conversation over to you. As you've mentioned, Dove has been doing this work for over two decades now, which is, I think, so incredible. Could you share an example of a purpose-driven campaign and maybe even touching on like the Dove self-esteem project?
Sure. So our most recent, the most recent work we did with TikTok creators was around the reverse selfie campaign, and this whole idea that the insight that we had that, again, that young girls, boys, young people all around the age of 13 start to use these different apps, filters, and tools to digitally distort their images. And it's all based on the pressures that come from social media. So no better place to go address these than social media. So we partnered with TikTok creators around our No Digital Distortion campaign, and to have the selfie talk, but with each other. So really using creators to instill body confidence, body neutrality, body positivity tips, taking the tips that we actually created for caregivers and using Gen Z creators to reach each other and speak to each other authentically in their own voices. Because one thing I've even learned working with young people is that as much as their mentors, their parents, you know, tell them one thing, they are much more impacted when it's young people to young people and they're reaching each other directly.
So my beautiful people. So I partner with Dove self-esteem projects to help build confidence and positive body image on social media. I believe it's time to delete the retouched ads off your phone and start posting the real you. Cause you are the beauty center. So post whatever you like and stop hiding behind edits and show off your true beauty. Also, I definitely want to encourage y'all to spend less time worrying about likes. Having the biggest following base don't define your worth. TikTok is all about having fun and expressing how you feel. So if you're confident in your craft and especially yourself, trust me, everything else will fall into place. Just continue to put out raw and dope content and stay consistent.
It's always been important for us to start doing that and really building advocates within the Gen Z community. But the activation on TikTok really let us use creators to connect with their communities in their authentic voices, in their own authentic ways, you know, and to instill that, you know, you really don't need to feel pressured to look a certain way, to also dispel myths that a lot of what you're seeing is actually not real. It's not attainable and it never will be. And then some also other tips on how to take breaks for social media, on how to unfollow, just like very general tips, but put it in their own authentic language so that they could connect with each other.
Thank you so much for sharing that with us, Kathryn. I know, Bryan and Bradford, you have such a unique and impactful way of connecting with your community, your TikTok community, and doing that for the force of good. I was scrolling through some of your content this morning, and I feel like your content is really driven by the people. Could you share more about how your brand joins these types of conversations, and more importantly, authentically?
The first thing worth saying is that there is something going on with the users of TikTok that does not happen on other platforms. If you look up the Two Blind Brothers hashtags on the other social platforms and look them up on TikTok, you will see something remarkable, which is people who unbox our Shop Blind challenge and then share the story of our brand. We've never received content like this. And essentially what it's done is it's put a face, a person, a story to those who resonate with what we're doing. And that does some interesting things. One is we then can use that content for advertising, to share that, to share what we're doing with others out there, be interested. And the astonishing thing, as Bryan mentioned earlier, is that that seems to perform a lot better than anything Bryan and I can actually produce. Somebody in their kitchen with an iPhone that's like going all over their living room in the background, offhandedly cooking food while explaining what we're doing, beats any thoughtful content that Bryan and I actually put out. The other thing, and this is really kind of touching, so every week with our team, we'll sort of grab some of those videos and share them out. Sometimes people in your community believe in you even more than you believe in yourself. Sometimes they will state what you're doing and how you're doing it in a way that actually inspires the whole team, raises the energy, raises the commitment, gives you goosebumps for that week. The way that we interact with them is by being active on the platform, reaching out to those people who give to us, and then we can give back to them. And by being kind of active advertisers as well, that's a way for us to get a lot of breadth on the platform, which then kind of helps us find those community members, those people who resonate most with our mission.
People are on TikTok to be entertained or to learn something or have fun and or enjoy their experience. They're probably not there just to hear from Brad and I or hear from any brand or hear from any advertiser. They're there for their own entertainment. So you need to fit into that mold. You need to fit into what they want to see, rather than trying to force your own ideas onto the people, because the more they feel like it's a native event on the platform, as soon as anybody feels like they're being advertised to, their BS meter goes to the roof, their walls go a mile high, and they stop caring about what you're saying. But when you're but the longer you can delay that, the longer you can interact with them on a one-to-one level, people feel like, oh, okay, I'm actually listening. I actually care. It was a hard lesson for us to learn, but it's been really helpful.
Especially today's generation, right? The Gen Zers, they have like the biggest BS detectors ever. And so they can really like just figure out if you're just not being authentic. And I think, you know, when you're talking about like advertising, right? Has there been any sort of like content or campaigns that you guys have done where it really showcases the authenticity of that?
So the first amazing thing is that you can test everything. So everything you get, you can put out there, and then, you know, the community will tell you what's working based on sort of the metrics you can see. I'll tell you though, some of it is just shocking. We have a video of a mother explaining to her 12-year-old what our brand stands for, and this kid is completely disenchanted and disinterested in what he's being told.
Online, it's called Two Blind Brothers, and you purchase something and the money goes towards research to the Blind Institute, but you don't know what you're getting. So it's really cool. So you have no idea what's in there.
we run this as an ad, and it outcompetes people who are enthusiastic. I mean, it's just so interesting. I mean, and that is the best example of the genuineness almost above everything else. And so, I mean, we have a lot of examples of that, but you know, the one that kind of was transformational for our business was a second grade teacher who did our shop blind challenge, where we challenged someone to buy something without seeing it first. And she did the unboxing in front of her class, and her teacher's assistant just candidly filmed it from the background. And her way of explaining the brand and the experience to a bunch of second graders, so it was done in a very kind of understandable from the position of an educator. That was our first kind of user generated content ad we ever ran, and it like melted the hearts of our community. We saw performance like we had never seen before. It touched everyone in our office, and it's a perfect example of something that would have been absolutely impossible 20 years ago. We only had the opportunity to speak to people's sense of quality into their wallets 20 years ago. Now, because of the digital age, we can actually share a nuanced message or a nuanced product with a nuanced community. And that theme is the whole success behind what you know, Bryan and I have been lucky to be beneficiaries of.
I would just build on that with a story from E.L.F. I think, so this idea that Brad is talking about, which is things have to be raw and undone. And I think what's incredible about TikTok is just how staggering the size of the community is and how endless their creativity is. And if they're really connected to your brand, so I think the job that you have to do as a brand is back to the theme of authenticity. You have to stand for something and then be consistent in that action. And if you do that, you are then gonna really galvanize a community to start spreading stories about your brand in a way that you would never be able to imagine that that's how I should be telling the story around my brand. So one quick example for E.L.F. There was a mom who was standing in Walmart, and she talked about wants to splurge on Prosecco and not on concealer. And she was holding up our 16-hour camo concealer. And we're all sitting there. This took off, this set a viral trend very organically. None of us would ever have been able to come up with this statement, but it was a perfect synthesis of what we stand for as a brand, which is about access and delivering that incredible quality at that jaw-dropping value. But the way that she boiled it down and made it relevant to her life and in a context that is going to resonate with a ton of other moms out there, that's not something that we ever would have been able to do. So I think the real job of brands also in the context of TikTok is do not approach the platform with any preconceived notions and just listen. Because I think if you listen and you keep your ear to the ground, there are so many rich gems out there that you can take and pluck and then just amplify and put a megaphone behind.
I was just going to add from our experience, we're relatively new on TikTok, and we came in to really reach young advocates, speaking directly to young people, speaking directly to each other. And I couldn't agree more with what everyone is saying, because never could we have come up with the content, or the way that they articulate it, to reach their own communities. And I just can't echo more what everybody is saying in terms of really allowing the creativity to be taken over and really letting it let them fly with it, because I think it's, especially with younger generation, Gen Z, I just think they have, and these creators have their own communities, their own ways of speaking and reaching and connecting with them. And it's been awesome to see the results. So I so relate to your story, because it's like the way that they articulate and come up with the content is nothing we could ever script ourselves.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And I think what is so amazing with the three different examples that you all shared is that there's just so much diversity and just breadth of just creators out there in this world, right, who are there to just storytell and just authentically share those things about your brand or about your mission. And, you know, the TikTok community is just so powerful. And I love how you all continuously like uplift voices and make sure that they have like a spotlight so that they can be heard. I want to open up the floor for just some dialogue on how TikTok creates such a unique ecosystem to lead with purpose. If anyone wants to chime in, feel free.
I think TikTok specifically, obviously all platforms have different age ranges, cohorts, audiences, et cetera. I think what's really unique about TikTok is number one, how active Gen Z is on the platform. And we talked earlier about how Gen Z is uber passionate about purpose. They lean into purpose. They're advocates themselves. I've met so many incredible people through the Delve Self-Esteem Project that they live their lives in purpose, right? And it's really incredible. I'm very much inspired by the younger generation today. So I think it's an amazing place to identify young advocates, people that are, we talked about passion, right? People that are extremely passionate about your purpose, that will get behind it, that will speak on your behalf, that will create content for you. So I think that's super unique to TikTok. But then also you have this really cool intergenerational connection, which was something that was really powerful for us on the Dove Self-Esteem Project, when we have to reach, again, caregivers, mentors, parents, et cetera, and young people.
What I love about TikTok is it stands for self-expression, and it stands for unbridled self-expression. You just have to show up just as you are on this platform, and that's absolutely the norm. And I think that's a big contrast between TikTok and some of the other social media networks that are out there. The other piece about TikTok, which I really admire, is whatever is happening on the back end with the algorithm. Because to me, it's back to really pushing this value of making fame accessible. You don't have to have thousands or hundreds of thousands of followers as a brand or as an individual creator to get noticed. You can just get noticed based on your talent. And that's something that I give TikTok a lot of credit for in terms of how that gets prioritized on the back end. You know, as an individual user, I've noticed that. And as we continue to disrupt on TikTok with E.L.F, we've also benefited from that. And so those are two things that I really think are magical about the platform that allow you to really drive you know, relentlessly a purpose-driven message and purpose-driven activations.
And I'm so happy you spoke to getting noticed. One thing Brad and I have found that's really fascinating on TikTok more than any other platform is when we get media inquiries from, you know, large and small publications, we always ask, you know, how did you hear about us? And the majority of them have come through TikTok in the recent months. And what we think is amazing is that's where I think a lot of these content producers are looking for new stories. And when you're a purpose-driven organization, you're a great story that people want to tell. They want to fill the magazines and the internet with stories like yours. So by being on the platform, by being out there, by telling your story, you're making yourself available to be found so that your story can get amplified to a larger degree.
You know, I think sometimes these stories and these messages that we share to the world, right, it takes a lot of time and just an incredible amount of like intention and thought, and aren't necessarily created overnight. And, you know, while these issues aren't new, there are situations that happen in real time, right, that needs like immediate conversations and immediate action. How does a brand kind of balance that, you know, between a long-term purpose-driven strategy with current events so that we can be in conversation today?
I think brands have to be unafraid to be able to take a stance, because I think, you know, you have the foundation, and then Michelle, to your point, there are things that are going to come up in the world all the time. And how does a brand actually react to that? And I think if brands can, again, stay very true to their purpose and just have the conviction to and courage to take a stand, because you're not going to be able to please everyone. But if you're able to stay really true to what you believe is right as a brand and what has been sort of built inherently into the values of a brand, then I think it also encourages that action versus sort of remaining silent. And I think that's the other piece for brands. I think a lot of brands have to, you know, they have those debates of, do we just sit this one out? Because we don't know what kind of reaction that's going to. And I think when you are really purpose-driven, while it's not always easy to figure out exactly what to do in that moment, I think that the best thing for brands is really you have to take a stand and you have to take that action and you have to have the courage and conviction and recognize you may not please everyone. And that's part of what it means to be a purpose-driven brand.
And it all comes down to the why. Why are you speaking up on this particular issue? What is the thing about it that resonates with everything that the brand stands for? I love this quote, the more personal, the more universal. You know, when people have discussions about purpose-driven brands, a lot of these grand ideas, we want to cure blindness, you know, we want to save the world. It really comes down to, it oftentimes comes down to the story of that one individual, that one family, that one community movement. You know, does a brand care about certain issues because of it has a percentage of its employees that are personally affected by it? You know, the why is so critical with that. It's tough for, you know, a group of marketers to sit around a room and figure out what they're going to speak to on certain issues. I think one thing that helps that discussion is thinking about why is it personal? Why is it personal beyond the larger context of wanting to do good in the world?
Yeah, thank you for sharing that. And did you want to go?
No, I did a phenomenal job. I don't have anything to be productive in this. I don't think I have anything additive to add to this conversation. So I'm gonna keep it going.
Awesome. Yeah, I feel like I could talk about this for days. I'm like so incredibly passionate about these types of topics. And, you know, it's always really important to just like keep your ear on the ground and just like continuously listen to the conversations that are being had right on the ground and how can brands stand for something. And at the end of the day, so many things are going on in this world simultaneously that I feel like having a purpose and having intentional, authentic work that we're doing on the day-to-day is doing something just bigger than ourselves. And so, you know, you are all being at the forefront of these conversations and driving change. What are some of the impacts that you have seen within your business when you lead with purpose?
From a business perspective, every time we lead with purpose, it's what differentiates Two Blind Brothers from any other company in the world. I mean, we make softer clothing than anybody else. I'm a little biased, but you know, it's true. It's a fact. But when we lead with our mission and we lead with our purpose and we lead with why we exist, that's what resonates with people. That's what gets so close to people's hearts. And that's where we can speak with the most passion and the most conviction. That's the story I want to tell. And so when we do that, all of our business metrics go up. But what's even more astounding is the personal stories that we get to hear in return. We'll hear from families that were just diagnosed with retinal eye disease. We'll hear from 7-year-old kids all the way up to 70-year-old grandmothers. And they're just looking for advice. They're looking for help. And Brad and I have the unbelievable privilege to be able to have those conversations, go back in time and give advice that we wish we heard as kids and pass on some wisdom that we've had. And when we look at our business, when we look at what the success metrics are, helping somebody through a diagnosis of blindness, even 1%, even 0.1%, is so much more valuable than basically anything else. And we feel so fortunate that we get to put out our message of authentically who we are and what we're doing and hope that can empower more like us. You know, the best thing in the world, the best case for Brad and I, and I'm sure everyone else feels the same way, is if there was 1,000,000 more companies like us, if everyone was more purpose-driven, because then the world is going to get to be a better place faster. And if this panel can be an example to one person listening to go out and start that business they're excited about or follow that passion project and help their community, their society, their group, then this panel's been awesome. I mean, that's the beauty of this. The bigger it's, the better it gets.
To me, it ties back to passion of the community. And I think what we see on media all the time with E.L.F. is our community jumping in. And, you know, there are times where we as a brand don't get it right. And most of those times, the community is jumping in and coming in our defense. And I think you don't inspire that kind of connection or that kind of passion for a brand if you're not leading with purpose. And so I think what I found with E.L.F. is happily, this has been so built within the ethos of the brand from the beginning. Standing for a democratization of beauty was really the initial spark behind the founding idea for this company. But I think over time, what I have seen is if you're able to embed that purpose with everything that you're doing, what that translates to is just inclusion from a community that then becomes the megaphone behind your brand.
And I think just to build, I think that we've seen when done correctly, when you have a really great product, right, that's going to service people and it meets their expectations, it's at a great price, it's sustainable, and you marry that with a very authentic purpose, you help people actually be able to engage and make change or have a positive impact on lives. I think you've heard a lot of us talk about like experiences that our brands have had positively on people's lives. I think that leads to brand growth. I mean, we've seen very much like when you have all of those working in tandem together, you know, you really are meaningful to people. You are different. You stand out against your competition and you're super salient. You stay very top of mind from a purchasing perspective. And, you know, when they're going to purchase, they'll think of your brand over others, not just because you have a great product, but because you have something that, you know, that you're personally connecting to, that they can connect to, or that they can, that really stands for something bigger. And I also think like the size of your brand, when I'm speaking on behalf of Dove, it also becomes a responsibility that we have too. I think that purpose is not really, it's non-negotiable too, right? When you have the power to use your platform and your voice and others' voices to do good and make a positive impact on the world, on society, on people, it becomes a huge responsibility. And I think people honestly just expect that.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that, you know, we're now starting to see this trend, right? Especially with the Gen Z generation of them completely shifting their spending budget to one brand or the other, depending on like what you stand for and kind of like the actions that you are taking. And I feel like you all shared a little bit along this line, but if there's just like a sentence or two that you can share with the audience today, what is like one tip for businesses who are wanting to start leading with purpose on TikTok?
You really have to dive into the soul of your brand and pull out of it what your brand stands for. Because if you're not clear on that, nothing, TikTok is not going to be able to tell you that. And you cannot invent purpose in there. So I think at least from the E.L.F. experience, there's the marriage of strategy. So really articulating what is it that your brand stands for, but pairing that with the soul of the brand and connecting those two pieces together. And I think once you have a relationship, what I love about TikTok is you feed a spark and they turn it into a forest fire. They just take something and they make it just explode. But that only happens if that authenticity is there and they really believe that what you say you want to do, you're doing, and it's something that you genuinely stand for.
I think my only build, and it was something as you were speaking, I think as you to brands that are on their journey to find their purpose or have one actually that's very deeply rooted in everything they do day to day. I think it would be to think about how that purpose is internalized for different types of people. Because I think that when I think about the work that we do in body confidence, what body confidence means to me might be something very different to many, many people that are listening, right? It's still extremely relevant, but how it's internalized, your personal experience with it, it's very personal. I think it's something we've talked about a lot today, the personal connection to that. Don't forget that you can go further and personalize those stories. And I think that's why platforms like TikTok are so powerful, because you can use people to authentically connect and tell those stories.
I'd like to share what you know, has been very valuable for Bryan and I, particularly for anyone who's kind of just getting started with this or considering sort of a purpose-driven brand. Bryan and I, we always have this question of scale. How much can our kind of this nuanced mission around blindness, how much can it grow? The good thing is we don't really care. We can just stay true to what we're doing. As long as we're having fun and we're supporting the cause that we care about, that is perfectly fine with us. Our greatest aspiration as a brand and is to watch others like us get to live the adventure and the purpose and the passion that we've gotten to experience with Two Blind Brothers. That's why being on a panel like this is so exciting for us.
My only add-on to what Brad said, or the thing I want to share last, is we love TikTok. We just love the platform. It's awesome. I don't know. Like, go if you're listening to this and you're thinking about doing anything, just go do it on TikTok. It's amazing. Don't. I'm not paid to say this. Like, we really legitimately love this platform. Go use it.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for sharing all of that. Kathryn, I think something that you said a little bit earlier today was just this intergenerational content. And I think that really spoke to me as well. I think it's so important to continuously like have these conversations, not only with the new generation, but then also speak to the voices who have, you know, come before us and just in the activism world, right? When we're talking about impact and purpose, folks have been doing this work for so many decades. And I think it is really, really important for us to not only like pay homage, but there are reasons why we're standing here talking about these things, having these conversations because of the work that they have been doing for so long. So anyways, that brings our discussion to a close. I do want to thank each and every one of you, Gayitri, Kathryn, Brad, Bryan, for sharing your unique experiences, but also insights and best practices on how purpose-driven brands can really create change. I also want to thank the TikTok team for hosting this event and for those of you who are tuning in today. Until next time.